evening, everybody. Welcome back to the living room. Thank you all for coming out tonight. Thank you to everyone online who has signed in to our support group tonight. We're really happy to have all of you. I know it's been a living room and extra living room challenge the last month and a half, so I really, really appreciate everyone continuing to come out and share your stories and learn all you can about lung cancer. We have Dr. Ged Gill from Carmanos Cancer Institute or Cancer Center in at Wayne State University in Michigan, which is far. He just flew in today to come out. It's far. To come out and talk to us today about KRAS. You guys have heard us talk about KRAS in the past as the largest known target in non-small cell lung cancer that doesn't have a drug for it. So we're going to learn a little bit about KRAS tonight, or a lot of bit about KRAS tonight, and talk a little bit in comparison about, you know, what is KRAS versus some of the other targets that are more well known that we talk about that do have those therapies for. But we're going to start with the around the room tonight. There are some new faces in the room. Please, everyone who's online, Andrea is not here tonight. She's homesick. So Jennifer is online moderating the chat. So please, please, please check in with Jen. Say hi. Load up your questions for Dr. Ged Gill as they come up. He's going to give a presentation tonight, but we are still encouraging Q&A throughout. So please don't feel like you need to hold your questions till the end. We'd love to hear from you during the presentation. So we're going to start with a little around the room. New people, please feel free to tell us who you are, how and why you're here, when you were diagnosed, what you were diagnosed with, and what you hope to get out of this. We really love to hear that feedback from, particularly from the new folks. Some of you old timers, we know why you're here, but the new folks, we want to welcome you. So, Stephen, would you like to start? Are you leaving? Okay. Oh, and for the new people, please remember to pick up your mic. The folks online can't hear what's happening in the room unless you're talking through a mic. So your turn comes around, don't forget to pick that up and speak loudly into it. Stephen.
Good evening. I'm Stephen Young, President and COO of the Adario Lung Cancer Medical Institute, which many of you have heard as known as Alchemy. Happy to be here.
Hi, I'm Athena Pavusko, and I have been diagnosed with non-small cell lung cancer, stage 4. I've had it a little over 3 years, and I'm fortunate I haven't had to have chemo or radiation, just Tarceva. And then 3 months after I got the lung cancer, I got the breast cancer, and I guess that's gone, I hope. And a couple months back, I got, they thought the lung cancer was growing, but I guess just the cells around the tumor had collapsed, so they thought it had grown by 26%, but it's just the cells. And then my rash side effect from the Tarceva has gotten bad, and now my lymph nodes in my neck are swollen, but my doctor hasn't seen me, but just by texting, he thinks it might be from my rash on my head, but I'm not sure because, like I said, there's no do-overs in cancer, so I'm trying to find out if those lymph nodes might be bad or not. Probably not, but anyway.
Thanks, Athena. Oh, you can share that way too. It doesn't matter.
My name is Charles Bain, and this is my first time here. I actually, by accident, I found this show because I couldn't sleep at night after being diagnosed, and I thought I was looking at sports pen TV show because there's nothing else on. And then I saw Bonnie, and it was like an amazing experience because at the time I was depressed. I was looking at the statistics and I thought I was gonna die. And the doctors were, the same messages that Bonnie was getting, I was getting. You know, well, you know, not many people survive this. You know, statistically speaking, and then Then there's Bonnie, who heard that same message, and she fought and she fought and she didn't take no for an answer, and it was just like, wow, that's my role model. So I was, it's really important, because your whole family is crying, and I felt so guilty and helpless, and I didn't know what to tell them, what's next, and what I knew wasn't exactly good news. There wasn't any hope. This whole program is hope, and they treat patients right, you know, because, well, in July, I was diagnosed with non-small cell adenocarcinoma, and at that time, they said it was 2B, and the plan was they're going to shrink it down, because it was about 7 centimeters in size, and likely they're going to have to cut my ribs doing a lobectomy. And they're trying to use that chemotherapy to kill all the things that are floating around. And then, so I went through chemo treatment, and I think it was cisplatin and vinorubin. That was really hard. I'm sensitive to the medications. Many times I felt nauseous, but even with the drugs that they used. But so they did a final PET scan, I think in January, and they said, okay, we don't see any signs of disease spreading. It shrunk a little bit, but we're going to proceed with a lobectomy on March 10th. And then they were like saying, okay, good, yeah, everything's fine. You know, we took another chest x-ray, we don't see anything. And then, you know, then a few weeks later when they did the surgery, they checked my lymph nodes and they found that the cancer spread. And then that was an intervention. I realized that autopilot with doctors that are like conventional oncologists and so forth, they may not have that experience and background to really know what's going on and how to handle lung cancer. Because the more I read about lung cancer, the more I realized it was an extremely complex disease. There's like hundreds of mutations, and if you miss it, that could be missing the boat on your life. And the other thing is the system. And the system is very frustrating because you have, I'm under Kaiser, and I hope I'm not taking too much time, but.
No, you're fine.
It's not standard of care to do the next generation sequencing where they check all the mutations, the hundreds of them that are out there. They only do the basic standard care. And I didn't test positive for any of those, of course. And I'm a non-smoker. There's probably something going on there, and the fact that it spread and it didn't quite work with chemo. But anyways, the other thing that happened to me was after they finished the procedure, and then they told my mother-in-law and my wife that the surgeon did that my chance of survival was small, maybe 5%. And then, that was on Thursday. And then from that point on, I wasn't sleeping. My wife was crying. They were all wondering, what's next? What are you going to do? What are you going to do? But at Kaiser, they just set up appointments. And I said, can someone talk to me? You know, I just want to know what's going on so I can. The uncertainty is it's unbearable. You know, you can't sleep. I didn't sleep at all. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, I finally get some answers. I mean, and then I started feeling a little better because it was like, okay, now I know I'm going to do chemo and radiation and so forth. But it can be extremely cruel to you or your family, the way they treat you in the system. And then I see some of the doctors on here, they're inspiring. I mean, I wish I could get the kind of support that they have on these stage here. But so I'm looking forward to finding a way to fight the system like Bonnie did, and then and beat this thing and be like the rest of you people, and you know, beat lung cancer, beat the system, and then, you know, just give this woman some respect and praise.
You know, it appears though he only was tested for two markers, so maybe. You and he could chat a little bit later. Yeah.
When we come to that portion of the presentation, when we're talking about targets and stuff, would be a great time to use this time and ask Dr. Gedgiel about molecular testing, what you were tested for, if it was just EGFR and ALK, what else out there might there be? What about NGS? What might that mean? So that would be a good time to bring that up and talk about it. We're glad you're here. Athena?
I'm a Kaiser patient too, and I am just really, I'd be scared to death if it wasn't for Bonnie, because they couldn't even tell which lung I had it in for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. And there was a big R on the scan, on the X-ray, and he thought it was in the left lung. And then he comes in and he says, we're gonna do a bronchoscopy, we're gonna go down your nose. And the nurse said, no, we're gonna go down your mouth. Then my doctor gave me the Tarceva, and him and his nurse said, well, we don't know much about this. Just make sure you use a lot of cream and don't get hot. That's all we know. And it's like, and then they told me to get back on the estrogen, and I found out later that that causes breast cancer, and I got the breast cancer. So I would be scared to death, and I can't really change Kaiser, and I'm sorry to have to say their name, but I am.
I'd like to say one thing to that, though. You know, people talk about institutions and doctors, and, you know, it's never really a building that's not okay. You know, sometimes we meet physicians that, you know, aren't up to speed with, you know, anything beyond the NCCN guidelines. So, you know, it's, I think there are some lovely doctors
really good
in
doctors.
Kaiser.
I can't say all of them are bad, but right. The thing is that I really don't think they're training their doctors on the latest stuff. The things I've come across that I've, you know, learned here that they don't know there, and that's what's upsetting to me. They're not training their doctors, and all you have to do is slip through the cracks and you're gone. You know, if we can hold on and not slip through the cracks, maybe we can survive. But this latest stuff coming out, they're not.
It's definitely, Athena, and to everybody, and we've talked about this before, you know, we recognize some of these gaps, particularly in community settings where these docs are treating all cancers, right? So they're not specialized, they're not fortunate enough to be able to bring their treatments down to one or two different types of cancers. So we recognize that one of the challenges in this day of precision oncology is how do we, and I think this is something that is very relevant in even speaking about KRAS and targets in general, how can we, as an organization, and how can you, as patients and caregivers, help to inform not only your physicians, but parts of your care team about what you learn here or in other, you know, arenas, and how we can not only help, the patients will say all the time, why did I have to come to you guys to find that out? And I don't want, you know, people to think that it means that they have bad doctors. I think the flip side is to look at it as, you know, things are happening fast, things are happening furiously, and you played a role in educating your own physician on one particular thing that he or she will remember the next time a similar situation comes out. It's sort of the reality in a lot of cases.
Well, and the whole genesis of having the living room is exactly what you're talking about, Athena. You know, the NCC guidelines, NCCN guidelines, are exactly that. They're a guideline. Mm-hmm. They're not a Bible. Mm-hmm. And what we like to do here in the living room is give you breaking news, you know, so you can go back and have an informed discussion with your physician, because many physicians are treating you by the book, so to speak. They're not doing anything wrong, but they're just not necessarily up to date, you know, with the latest and greatest programs. So
all I can remember is what Dr. Gandara said, if they don't keep up with what's going on in the last 6 months, they gotta go back to medical school. So I feel like the only thing I can do with my doctors sometimes is just hold my temper, because I don't have the patience with them and I don't have the brain power to tell a doctor what to do. And the other thing is, they don't want us normally telling them what to do, you know, mm-hmm.
Well, you know, you were here for the informed decision program last week, right?
I got to go to the first one, not the second.
Okay. Yeah, you know, it was all about how to speak to your physician and how your physician can speak to you. That, you know, the ultimately perfect situation is where your physician knows what your needs are and that you know what the physician's needs are and that you can have that shared discussion and, you know, your voice is heard and their voice is heard as well.
Thank goodness for you because you connect the dots.
Well, maybe that's what we are, dot connectors.
Well, and it's, I think one of the things that we, most of you know that one of the services we provide is to help facilitate second opinion with docs who specialize in lung. And it doesn't necessarily mean, you know, if, because I know Athena, you went up to and saw Dr. Gandaro. It doesn't mean you have to be treated there. Kaiser's your insurance, but docs like Dr. Gandaro are more than willing to work with the community hospital docs on a treatment plan that works best for you and to have those conversations. So that is one of the services that we are fortunately right. able to provide right. so that we can try to help.
But you know, it's bad enough to be told you have cancer and to get on the internet. And if you, the first thing you do is you see all this old stuff where people aren't living more than 6 months. It's like pancreatic cancer. And then you have to play this politics. You know, it's not mm-hmm. fair for a sick person to have to, you can barely think. How are you going to educate your doctor, you know? Right. I'm glad you're doing it for us because, right. I mean, there's really good doctors out there, but the ones that aren't are scary. It's really scary out there. When they can't, he's an old man. He was at least my age, and he couldn't read an X-ray. I said, doctor, there's an R there. I remember them putting the R on the X-ray so you don't. So anyway.
Yeah.
It's frustrating.
Well, we're happy to help facilitate better care.
Yeah, I guess I'm an old timer now. My name is Candace. I have stage 3B non-small cell lung cancer. I finished my treatments in November of 2014, and now I'm just, you know, in between scans. And I also have it in my chest lymph nodes. I also have Kaiser. I understand the general sense of frustration that's being expressed here, and I won't go into details, but I have some similar experiences. I mean, I think in the end, being here and having additional knowledge is what will springboard you forward and not have to just be bogged down in the Kaiser system. And I appreciate you very much. I'm happy to be here.
Thanks, Candace.
My name is Tina, and I have been here a long time. yeah, it's all good. I was diagnosed over five years ago, and I went through treatment and at stage 3B, and went through treatment, and then started on Tarceva as a maintenance, and it's been 4.5 years on Tarceva, and so far, everything's good.
I'm Doris, and I'm relatively new. I came out here sometime October of 2015, been diagnosed in August 2015, non-small cell lung cancer, stage 4 adenocarcinoma, EGFR positive. And so I'm taking Tarceva right now. And after my initial PET scan, I've had two PET scans. The last one was 2 weeks ago, and no signs of growth, major shrinkage of the cancer cells. So hoping and praying that, you know, like Athena, yeah, no chemo, no radiation. Hopefully it will continue on. I'm with Kaiser, but I did go for the gene testing, and yeah, they allowed me to do that, and it came out really EGFR positive, and I went for a second opinion as well with UCSF, and same treatment recommendation. So far, so good. And I'm glad to be here. It's
Thanks,
really
Doris.
Very nice, and to be able to learn more beyond what I hear from my oncologist or from what I read in the internet, which is really dreadful sometimes.
Yeah, the internet's tough.
I'm Maynard, the husband and caregiver of Doris. I'm happy to be here.
Very important person.
Hi, my name is Sarat. I was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer in December. I started my treatment about 5 weeks ago, and I'm taking two drugs. One is carboplatin, plus I'm taking Alinta, I think. I'm not too good with these names, but.
Yeah. You're right.
when I first started, I had a horrible cough. I play a lot of golf, and I thought, oh, it's one of those golf coughs, but it didn't go away. So I had a X-ray, and I had a, what did I have after that? The conclusion was I have stage 4 non-small cell carcinoma. So I'm on a series of 6 chemotherapies. I just finished 2, and the third one I did it 5 days ago. So the first thing that happened was after the first treatment, after about the 8th day, my cough started going away. And after about 15 days, I completely don't have a cough anymore. I don't know what that means. I'm an engineer, so I don't know what that means till the engine runs, you know? So.
I can say it's a good thing.
It's a good thing. It's a good
thing. So then.
Of course, the proof is in the pudding, and we'll have to wait for the scans.
Yeah, yeah. Now, the other thing was. I play golf, but I always walk the course. But I couldn't do that when this thing happened. But now I played golf 3 times since then, as late as week ago, and I don't have that problem where when I walk, I'm not puffed from the breathing. So the only 2 things I know. Then I was they did some testing. Oh, I forget.
K-R-A-S.
I was
just what I said.
This KRAS mutation that I have.
KRAS. There's the expert right here.
So it's kind of interesting. I mean, I didn't even know about this. We live in New Zealand quite a bit at the time, so we came here for treatment, and then my friend said, "There is this great thing happening tonight. You better go and listen to this talk." So that's why I'm here. So I was told today that after the 3rd infusion, they're going to give me a PET scan and find out where it's going. So that's all I know. And then, and my wife is my chief caregiver, so she'll have other answers. Thank you very much.
My name is Linda, and I used to work in oncology for many years on the laboratory end, and I never thought I'd be at the caregiver end. I'm glad I have that knowledge. It's quite outdated, I have to say, and we're both working really hard to learn everything we can. We've had a wonderful guide in our lives. My husband's cousin is a surgeon in New York, but he's now a cancer researcher in non-small cell lung cancer. He rings us every other day, and he's also been a great educator for us about the terminology, about the gene testing, et cetera. So we haven't had feelings of like we're down the wrong path. In Sarat's case, we understand that the first step is to go through conventional chemotherapy. And our friend is so encouraging. He says, "You got to stay alive for 8 more months. You ought to see all the stuff that's coming down the line." And so we've managed to be real positive. And I have to say that we are Kaiser patients. We've been very happy with the efficiency and the professionalism, and we've had really not one single complaint along our path at this point. And we're very happy to be here. Just by some lucky email last night, we came.
That's awesome.
Hi, my name is Jeff. This is actually my first time here. I actually just learned about this organization recently while I was online. I am not a lung cancer sufferer or survivor. I just found Bonnie's story, the mission of this organization, and you know the statistics around lung cancer very compelling, and I wanted to come down and just learn a little bit more about it, meet the people behind this organization and the people that you guys are providing support to. Yeah, but all of you are extremely brave. I'm very impressed at you know everything that you guys are you know fighting through and just keep it up. Yeah.
Are you in in oncology or in health the health world?
Actually, I'm currently not. I have a lot of friends and family that are in the biotech space.
Okay.
My girlfriend is a global development team lead at Genentech.
Okay.
And I have a lot of other friends that are clinical scientists as well. Yeah.
Okay. Great. Well, welcome.
Yeah. Welcome. Maybe our research and awareness is doing some good out there. Someone who doesn't, not affected yet, but here.
Right.
My name is Scott Santarello. I'm the president of the organization, Bonnie J. Dario Lung Cancer Foundation. And it's nice to hear someone like you being here because one of our biggest challenges we have is trying to get the word out to the world that anyone with lungs can get lung cancer. And how do we do that so that when they actually need us, they can find us? So thank you for that. And we'll continue to do all we can to raise awareness and be here for all of you moving forward.
Good evening. My name's Katie Wilcox, and I am a part of the foundation. I am, I guess my title is Manager of National Events. So I help put on the 5K runs, and we'll be putting on the gala and golf. And I think later on in the program, we'll share some of the upcoming events that we have taking place. So it's great to hear everybody's stories. Thank you for sharing.
So, do you want to give your history? We skip you all the time, but I think that since there's new people in the room, we kind of forget because it's been so long, right?
Which is a good thing, right?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, that's old news.
But I think it's important because we've got some new folks.
Okay. I was diagnosed 12 years ago, stage 3B, non-small cell adenocarcinoma. I was never tested genomically because they weren't testing at that time. Tarceva was actually in clinical trial. So I was put through chemotherapy and radiation and surgery. I had a tumor that was on my aorta and my subclavian artery and was told by several physicians that there was nothing they could do for me. So I'm all about fighting. I'm all about second opinions. I'm all about not stopping necessarily at the first diagnosis if it doesn't feel right for you. And that's really the genesis of starting this foundation. I went through several physicians that weren't telling me what I wanted to hear, and finally found somebody that said, well, you want to fight? You feel like fighting? You know, we can throw a lot of chemo at you and a lot of radiation and some surgery if we're lucky enough to shrink the tumor. And I said, hell yes. So here I am. So, you know, never give up and never stop educating yourself on what's new. Because as you'll hear tonight, there's lots new in lung cancer. So we welcome all of you always.
And for the new folks who, some of you I've spoken with either over email or the telephone, but for those of you who I haven't met, I'm Danielle Hicks, and I run patient services and programs here, along with my team. I don't know where the other part of my team that's here tonight is, but she's here somewhere. And I'm so happy that you all are, is she behind the camera? I just can't see her. There's Michelle. I'm going to make her introduce herself, particularly because we have new folks in the room. But thank you all for coming. You know, for those of you who also don't know me, Bonnie's my mom. So lung cancer started with me back in 2003 when she was diagnosed, but has come so much farther since then, and it's because of each and every one of you that we, and not just my mom and I, but every member of our team, gets up every day and is passionate and committed to this cause and what we're doing. So give yourselves a big round of applause, because you are why we do what we do. Yeah. So with that, I'm going to ask Michelle just to introduce herself. I see her standing over there by the food.
I'm Michelle Zay. I work with Danielle in patient services and programs with all of you great people. And I've been here 2 years.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah.
And I get lucky to see you guys every month.
Thanks, Michelle. And I've got David and Ganeet in the back, too. Sorry, I'm calling out team members. I will not call you out. I promise.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Ganeet Walia. I'm the Senior Director for Research and Medical Affairs here at the Foundation. My job is to oversee the global research enterprise, the grants that we fund all over the world on lung cancer research. And I also work on the alchemy side of things, on the studies that we run in the lung cancer space. It's so awesome to get to interact with all of you, because that gives me purpose for what I do every day. It motivates me to get up every morning and come here and do what I do every day for all of us.
Thanks, Ganeet.
My name is David LeDuc. I'm the Senior Director of Strategic Alliances for the Addario Lung Cancer Medical Institute. I'm gonna echo very much what Ganeet said. When I hear your stories, it's a reminder of why we do what we do. I have a personal connection with a father who passed away from cancer and two grandparents specifically from lung cancer. And every day I think about those folks, but your stories add kind of fuel to the fire, so to speak, of what I do. In my role, I get the pleasure of working with a lot of the folks, like the good doctor up front and Stephen and others. And I always say I try to get a lot of smart people in the room together, let them figure out ways that we can help patients, and then my job is to go out and figure out how to pay for it. So if you ever want to talk about helping us with those things, I'm around, and I'll be glad to have those conversations. So thank you.
And now I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer, who maybe you could just introduce yourself really quick and then introduce the folks online.
I'm Jen. Most of you guys know me. I'm the Director of National Events. I'm taking over for Andrea's day because she's at home sick. Just kidding. Online, I just wanted to say hello to Karen, Tom, Mara. All of our Florida people are here. Aww. So give them a shout out.
Great. Thank
and
you.
I do have a question, but I don't think we're ready for them yet. Well,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want it now?
Mara has a question about KRAS.
Sure. Okay. Oh, it's about KRAS?
Yeah.
Yeah, then let's wait, because we might go there. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Ged Gill.
Finally.
Finally. I know. So we can hear what he has to say.
First of all, thank you. I want to thank all of you. I'm coming here really because I want to learn. I feel every interaction I have with patients, I try my best, and I'll tell you I don't succeed all the time. But to me, every patient is an individual. We sometimes get lost in blood tests and scans and genomic results. And I really don't like to call this right-sided adenocarcinoma with EGFR mutation positive. It's an individual. And there's a lot that is going on beyond lung cancer and the treatment. And I can see that when I hear from all of you. And you know, I really hope that we as doctors, through such forums, can remind ourselves that it's not just about doing the chemotherapy or doing the scans and acting on it, but being sure that we are managing a patient. And I really enjoyed listening to everything you said. I, of course, want to thank Bonnie Addario and all the wonderful members of the organization for what you do. I just want to start off, before I get to the topic at hand, two things. In general, the NCCN guidelines are a good sort of a basic recipe to sort of go ahead with, but you do have to individualize. And I assure you that all the doctors who've come here before me, much smarter than me, they would be very happy, including me, to get an email or get a call, even if it is, you don't know them. It doesn't have to be through another doctor colleague. I can say this quite confidently, in the lung cancer community, among the physicians at least, it's a personal thing. And if there's any way we can help, so if you do want to reach out to any of the doctors who've come here, and I believe that the foundation can, you know, give you names, they would be more than happy to provide you with some guidance. It won't be as comprehensive and thorough as it would be if you actually went to see them, but I don't think any doctor would sort of decline as long as it... So never hesitate to reach out. It doesn't always have to be in person. Some of these things with all the technology that exists can be done remotely. And the other thing is that most community physicians, I genuinely believe, do a wonderful job. I actually envy them because I have the fortune of focusing just on one cancer, and I can tell you there are times when I learn about things that I was not aware of. For the most part, they do a wonderful job. Yes, it's getting more and more challenging to be good at everything, and I think what the skill is to seek access when you think you need to. So it's to be able to recognize when you need to get the advice from some other physician or get advice from some other organization so that you can provide the best care to the patient. Because at the end of the day, it is being sure that we are providing the best care to our patient. It doesn't matter whether it's coming from you or from some other physician. So I just want to make some general observations before I got started on the topic at hand. So I've come here with some slides. The slides are just a way of, if it's okay, I'm going to stand when I talk. I like to move around. The slides are really just a way of providing a guide. Please interrupt me, even the online folks, they can interrupt me. I only decided to have slides because my perception, and I'm sure it's probably wrong, but is that KRAS may not be as well understood in the patient population as probably something like EGFR and ALK or some of the other genetic markers for which we have targeted therapy. As of now, there is no approved targeted therapy for KRAS, and therefore I labeled this as the orphan marker, but probably things are changing. Actually, what is important to know about KRAS before I get into the actual slides is KRAS was the first genetic alteration identified almost 30 years ago as a driver genetic alteration in lung cancer. And so despite being aware of this genetic alteration for almost 30 years, we have not yet developed a targeted treatment like we have with some of the other markers in lung cancer. I always like to sort of remind myself, whenever I do a presentation, I always do an incidence slide only because it is a big problem. So unfortunately, even today, the number of patients who die from this disease is equal to or exceeds the next four common causes, and therefore we have these forums, and therefore this is such an important disease to address. So I, as a doctor, remind ourselves, and I only thought I should mention this because of two reasons. One is, I have recognized now that when patients look up success rates with EGFR inhibitors or ALK inhibitors, they are somewhat disappointed. What do you mean that the disease is controlled for 12, 13 months, and then you have to go to, on an average, and then you have to go on to something else, and then that controls? So I thought I'll put up this slide because this is where I started. So I started on faculty in 2000. And in 2000, one other reason why I thought I'll put this up is, as of now, in 2016, the genomic data, the genomic information about the tumor is leading to therapeutic implication primarily in advanced stage disease. So primarily in stage 4 disease. And Daniel and I were talking about this earlier. As of now, in early stage disease, so if I divide lung cancer very broadly into stage 1 and stage 3, and then stage 4 or patients with stage 1 and 3 who have had a recurrence. So that would be one group of patients, and then stage 1 to 3 would be another group of patients. As of now, the standard of care is still to use either surgery, chemotherapy, or radiation, or a combination of those. And you may still get genomic markers analyzed, and only in selective patients one can discuss the utilization of these targeted drugs. But as a standard practice as of now, we are still not using the targeted drugs in early stage disease. And that's because we don't have evidence that the targeted drugs will improve upon the cure rates that we achieve with surgery, radiation, and chemotherapy in early stage disease. And I hope I've sort of communicated that. So the genomic data is primarily being utilized in advanced stage, that is stage 4 disease, or patients who have recurrence from an early stage disease. And so the reason I put up this survival curve is that this is where we were 15 years ago. So 15 years ago when I started on faculty, what had changed, and the reason I'm giving this historical perspective is, we doctors therefore view all the data that has been generated over the last 10 years with this sort of background, and therefore may look at it more positively than what the patients may perceive when they actually look at the data. So actually going before even 2000, in the 80s, 90s, one wondered whether for stage 4 lung cancer one should even use chemotherapy, because one, the chemotherapy drugs that were utilized then were not as effective, and secondly, we didn't have as good of supportive care medications to help the patient through these chemotherapy drugs. What changed was in late 1990s, there were several new drugs, chemotherapy drugs, that were introduced that were effective, a little more than what the previous drugs were, but more importantly, they were better tolerated. And each of these drugs were combined with a platinum compound, either a cisplatin or carboplatin. And this study, this was a large study of almost 1,500 patients conducted by a cooperative group called ECOG. And the purpose of this study was to identify which chemotherapy combination that had been developed in the late 1990s, these were the new combinations back then, provided the best outcome in stage 4 lung cancer. Again, I'm specifically talking about stage 4 here. And unfortunately, the results were disappointing. They produced a benefit, but the benefit was very modest. So there was all this excitement in the late 1990s. We had all these new chemotherapy drugs. And the conclusion when we started this century was, yes, chemotherapy works, but probably doesn't work as well as we want it to work. And I feel that in the last particularly 5 years, there have been three changes that have really changed the outcome of this disease and is going to show eventually an improvement in 5-year survival. One is the identification of what we call molecular alterations in lung cancer, and I'll come to this issue because that's the topic at hand. And what this sort of shows is that you have non-small cell lung cancer. Back in 2000, the only thing we really cared about was whether the patient had non-small cell or small cell lung cancer, because the treatments were different for non-small cell lung, non-small cell and small cell. We did not care about what the subcategories of non-small cell lung cancer the patient had, adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma. We knew about this, but the reason we didn't care is because the treatment did not change depending upon whether you had adenocarcinoma or squamous cell cancer. With the introduction of Alimta, the chemotherapy you're on, that was the first change that occurred in the treatment of stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer, because Alimta is one chemotherapy that works very well in adenocarcinomas, but absolutely does not work or hardly works in squamous cell lung cancer, so we don't use it in squamous cell lung cancer. So that was one of the first triggers to say it is not just sufficient to know whether you have non-small cell or small cell, but you need to know what histology you have. And then the next thing that changed over the last 10 years is that based on whether you have non-squamous cell or adenocarcinoma, we have identified several genetic alterations that are the primary drivers of the cancer. And if one is able to target that specific driver of the cancer, one can have therapeutic benefit where the cancer shrinks. And I'll elaborate on this in the subsequent slides. The second thing that has changed the treatment paradigm is the introduction of immune therapy. And that may have special relevance for the KRAS mutation positive patients. And again, I'm going to mention about this subsequently when I discuss about KRAS in general. And the third thing that may seem odd in the context of advanced stage disease is I think the data set that probably will land up making the biggest impact in the outcome of this disease is the introduction of lung cancer screening. So back in 2002, the NIH conducted a large clinical trial called the National Lung Cancer Screening Trial, where they took 52,000 individuals who had a specific smoking history, that is, they had smoked for about 30 years, a pack a day. So two packs a day for 15 years is equal to one pack a day for 30 years, or three-fourths of a pack a day for 45 years. So who had a 30-pack-year smoking history between the ages of 55 to 75 and had not stopped smoking within 15 years of going on this study. The reason they selected this group is because there were mathematical models that were conducted before the study was started, that if somebody has this characteristic, the lifetime risk of developing lung cancer is 2%. And so it was felt that CAT scan screening would be beneficial if the person had that kind of a risk. So they took 52,000 individuals with 30-pack-year smoking history between the ages of 55 and 75. 26,000 individuals got CAT scan once a year for 3 years. 26,000 got chest x-rays once a year for 3 years. They only did it once a year for 3 years because that's all the government could afford. At a median follow-up of 6 years, so this was not full follow-up, but an average follow-up of 6 years, it showed a 20% reduction in the risk of dying from lung cancer. And that was primarily because in most of the patients that are diagnosed with lung cancer as of now, almost 75% of the patients either have stage 3 or stage 4 disease. And only 25% of the patients approximately have about stage 1 to 2 disease. Whereas in the patients who got the CAT scan screening, over 90% of the patients had stage 1 lung cancer, and less than 5% of the patients had stage 3 or stage 4 lung cancer. So you shifted the stage to early stage disease that is a lot more curable. And that's why the survival improved. And actually, not only did it reduce the lung cancer-related mortality, but overall survival was improved in these individuals for 7 years. It speculated that if the screening was done longer, more than 3 years, that maybe the benefit is even greater, but that's speculation. Yes, this is a group of individuals that already have lung cancer, and this data may not be relevant, but I feel this is an important information that is not as well known. We know about breast cancer screening and prostate cancer screening and colon cancer screening, but this is not something that is well known, particularly among the primary care physicians, and so I like to mention it at every stage possible because this may have as much of an impact as all the advances that we are making in advanced with the targeted therapy and the immune therapy. So before we, partly I'm presenting it this way, this is the sort of discussion I have during my first consultation. And so I thought since we are talking about KRAS and targeted therapy, I thought I'll mention this as cancer is a result of multiple genetic alterations that can occur in some cells of your body. So we are all made up of cells. In general, these are round in structure, and I'm not a great artist, and nor am I very good with technology, so this is not the best way I could have represented it. But most of the cells are round in structure, and they're really tiny. So on the tip of my little finger, there could be up to 1 million cells. In each of our cells, we have two sets of genes, one from our father, one from our mother. And it's the set of genes that tell each of our cells what they're supposed to do. So in the lung cells, the genes give a certain set of instructions to the lung cells, and that's what makes it function as a lung cell. The same set of genes in the heart cells give a different set of instructions, and that's what makes it function as a heart cell. So we are made up of billions and billions of cells working together under the directions of the genes that we inherited, and the same set of genes that are present in each of our cells that makes our body tick. During our lifetime, we can pick up damages to these genes. The damage could occur through many different things, things in the environment, things in the diet, things in the water. One of the things, of course, that can damage the genes, particularly in the lung cells, is smoking. Now, when I say damage, doesn't mean all the genes get damaged. Only some of the genes get damaged, only in some of the cells. We don't understand why only some of the genes get damaged, only in some of the cells. Couple of other things about gene damage. If you had three different individuals growing up in the same area, same background, let's say they all were smoking cigarettes, same type of cigarette, same duration of time, one person may not develop any gene damage in any of the lung cells. Another person may develop something like this kind of a gene damage. A third person may develop completely different gene damage. Why different individuals, despite getting exposed to the same, let's say, environmental carcinogen, either don't pick up any gene damage or pick up different types of gene damages? Again, something we don't understand. And just because somebody picks up a gene damage doesn't automatically mean there's a consequence. There's enough redundancy within our genes that the remaining normal genes can provide normal commands and the cells can continue to function normally. However, if the damage occurred at certain specific points along the genes, the damaged genes start giving wrong commands. Ignore the title of this slide. This is mainly to represent what happens when these genes, the damaged genes, there are specific damaged genes that occur. And that leads to a normal cell transforming into a cancer cell, wherein the cancer cell keeps on multiplying when it is not supposed to. It survives for a longer period of time. There are certain cells that die in our body so that the rest of the body can function properly. And then develop the ability to detach from the main mass, get into the blood vessels, and can travel to other parts of the body and start growing there. Normal cells do not have the capacity to detach from where they are located and go to other parts of the body. Cancer cells have the ability because the damaged genes make them do so. So any cancer is our own tissue that is growing and that develops the ability to spread to other parts of the body, because there are damaged genes that are making that tissue do that. Now, please understand, these are not genes that were damaged, these are not inherited damaged genes. Most individuals who develop cancer probably inherited normal set of genes. And yes, there are certain inherited cancer syndromes, but they are mainly seen in children. But in adults, when cancer occurs, they usually have inherited a normal set of genes from their parents, but they acquire gene damage during their lifetime because of an exposure to an environmental agent. In lung cancer, in many lung cancer patients, that happens to be cigarette smoke, though why certain individuals do land up getting lung cancer and others don't, despite getting exposed, we still don't understand that very well.
So Dr. Gagiel, I don't want to interrupt.
Sure, please go ahead.
But when we're talking about that damage in the gene, why people may not, based on exposure, so particularly when we're looking at the never smoking group, who, as far as they know, didn't grow up in a highly polluted area or with high levels of radon. Is it sort of the same thing? I mean, I know we've had docs in here before that on some level are just like, we don't know why.
So just to answer that question, yeah. I'm going to say, I don't know how many of you know this, but even among long-term cigarette smokers, only 15 to 20% land up getting lung cancer.
Right.
If cigarette smoking was the only factor, a majority of people who smoke should get lung cancer.
Right.
So what we know is that there are probably other factors. Asbestos is one, radon is one. Maybe they have certain genes that are running in their family that make them susceptible to these gene damages that lead to cancer formation. So what I'm trying to say is that, yes, clearly there is a connection between cigarette smoking and lung cancer, but that doesn't mean that's the only factor. But in that particular individual, what other factors led to lung cancer development? And so that's true for never smokers also. What I can say about never smokers is that if you look at the data from US and Japan, most of the never smokers are usually in urban areas. It's uncommon to see happens. It's less common to see never smokers from rural areas. And this is why environmental pollution, we think of environmental pollution as just car pollution or industrial pollution. So for example, there's data to show that in Asian countries and even India where I come from, environmental pollution also includes indoor pollution. So there has been an increase in the incidence of lung cancer among women never smokers in Asian countries, including in India, because the cooking practices, the food, the way it is prepared, there's a lot of frying and there's a lot of fumes that are created. Many of these individuals live in much smaller dwellings than what they do here in US, which don't have the best ventilation. So when we think of pollution, we think of, you know, smog from, or the, you know, pictures from 80s. Even in India, we used to see these pictures from the 80s of LA with a dense cloud of smog. But yes, that can be associated with lung cancer, but pollution can be in a variety of factors. But in an individual patient, one can never say what specific factor led to the development of lung cancer. I don't know if I answered your question.
I,
yeah.
I think you did.
Yeah.
So the reason I thought I will discuss this is that in most lung cancer patients, it is a multiple genetic alterations. Now, what are genes at the end? Genes are codes for substances. And so a gene is active. Not all genes are active in all cells. In lung cells, certain genes are active. In heart cells, certain genes are active. And these genes, let's say in lung cells that are active, are a code for substance. That substance has a specific function in the lung cells, which allows the lung cells to function as lung cells. Similarly, a different set of genes produce certain substances that are relevant in a heart cell that allows the heart cell to function as a heart cell. Most cancers are a result of multiple genes that have altered, as a result of which the substances that they code for are either hyperfunctioning or not functioning at the right level. And it's this altered functionality of these different substances that leads to the alteration of the cell from a normal cell to a cancer cell, where the cancer cell is dividing, spreading, and metastasizing. But what we have identified over the last 10 years is that in some lung cancer patients' cancer, we can identify one particular gene that is the primary driver of the cancer. And what that means is that the substance produced by that altered gene is altered. It's usually hyperfunctioning. And that hyperfunctioning substance is driving the cancer in terms of how the cancer grows and how the cancer spreads. And if you target that substance, since the cancer is kind of addicted to that substance, when you target that substance, the cancer shrinks, because the cancer can't survive, can't proliferate, can't metastasize if that substance is not hyperfunctioning, not just functioning, but hyperfunctioning. I hope I've sort of communicated that properly. Now, it would be naive to think. So one example is EGFR mutation, right? So what happens in EGFR mutation? EGFR gene is mutated. As a result, the EGFR substance produced by the mutated EGFR gene is hyperfunctioning. EGFR gene has normal relevance in skin and gut. But in normal lungs, it does have relevance, but in lung cancers with EGFR mutation, the EGFR gene is mutated, so the EGFR substance that is produced is hyperfunctioning, and that is what is driving the cancer. So if you give a drug that blocks EGFR, the cancer shrinks, and therefore the patient derives benefit. But it would be naive to think that in an EGFR mutation positive lung cancer, that is the only gene that is driving the cancer. Yes, it's the main gene, but that each patient's cancer has probably other genes that are contributing to what we call the cancer phenotype, the cancer that has occurred in that patient. And therefore you see this variability. I heard there are individuals who've been on Tarceva for 4 or 5 years, and then I have patients with EGFR mutation lung cancer in whom the cancer has grown within 6 months. So this variability probably is because There are probably other genes that may not be the main driver, but do influence the cancer. And so the benefit from a particular targeted therapy is variable. As I'm also going to mention, we view of these mutations as one homogeneous group, and this is very relevant for KRAS. There are many types of mutations within, say, EGFR mutation or KRAS mutation, and the variability in the mutations also can determine outcomes and benefit from these drugs. So what this pie chart shows is that we have now identified, at least in some patients, the main driver of the cancer, and I hope everybody now understands what I mean by the driver of the cancer. It's about 15% of adenocarcinomas in the United States. The primary driver is EGFR mutation, wherein the EGFR that is produced by the mutant EGFR is hyperfunctioning. And when you look at KRAS, it accounts for about 30%. There are some series that say about 25%. KRAS mutation is seen in squamous cell also, but it is much less common, probably in the range of 2%. So if you look at all non-small cell lung cancers, it's about 20% or so, 20 to 25% of all non-small cell lung cancers have KRAS mutation as the main driver of the cancer. And that actually, we were just calculating these numbers, equals to almost, not completely, almost to the total number of small cell lung cancers that are diagnosed in the United States. So it's a big issue for lung. So now what is KRAS? And I put up this figure, and I hope I don't get too technical, but this is just to provide a sort of concept about what is exactly is KRAS. Most of the genetic alterations that have been identified, so this pie chart that I showed you, most of these genetic alterations, the genes that are altered appear to be coding for substances that are important in what we call cell signaling. And give me a couple of minutes just to explain this. What I mean by that is, for our cells to function, they need to communicate with each other. So the way they communicate with each other is a cell will secrete a certain substance or a factor. That factor or a substance will go to the adjoining cell, to the nearby cell, and bind to what are called as receptors that are present on the cell surface. So I showed you that round cell. So think of this, on the round cell, there are these things jutting out, which are called receptors. And this is the cell membrane here shown, and these are sort of the receptors where there is a component sticking out outside the cell membrane. There's a component that traverses the cell membrane, and then there is a component within the cell itself. And what happens is that the way cells communicate with each other is they'll secrete a substance which will come and bind to the receptor. This binding of this factor will activate the receptor, and this then activates several proteins downstream, which then has the desired effect. So when a cell communicates, it wants an effect in the other cell. That's how the body functions. It keeps the harmony. What has been seen is that when these genes get altered, or the genes coding for these receptors get altered. So one example is EGFR. So what happens in EGFR mutation is that the EGFR now that is produced is such that it doesn't need a factor to come and bind. It is always active. So a receptor will only get active when a factor comes and binds to it. Whereas in EGFR mutation positive receptor, it is always active. It doesn't need the receptor to come and bind, and therefore it always sends down signal down the cell, and it is always creating the effect. And the effect of EGFR is the cells divide, the cells develop the ability to spread. And so that's why, and what I'm trying to say is that cell signaling molecules are the primary target of these genetic alterations. And therefore, cell signaling appears to be an important factor in cancer formation. So the molecules or the substances that are involved in cell signaling, wherein the cells communicate with one another, those have been identified the primary genes that are altered as the main driver of the cancer. And one particular cell signaling protein is RAS. The difference between EGFR and RAS is EGFR is a receptor on the cell surface. RAS is more within the cell, And it's a primary sort of point where several of these receptors go and activate RAS, and RAS then activates some of the downstream proteins, which then has the effect where the cells divide, cells survive, cells spread. So RAS is more at the bottom. Now, the important thing about RAS is it functions when it is bound to something called as GTP. So once RAS gets activated, it is bound to something called as GTP. And the body tries to keep this in balance. When it doesn't want RAS to be active, it degrades it back to GDP, and then RAS is not active. When it needs activation, it converts it to GTP. The RAS-GTP complex is really tightly bound. It is the tight affinity between RAS and GTP that has made it challenging to develop blockers. The affinity is so strong, the magnet is so strong, that you have a hard time to think of two magnets that are really tightly, that you can, it's very hard to get a drug in the middle of the two so that you can disconnect the joining of RAS and GTP and thus lead to RAS not functioning. And the reason what happens in RAS mutation is that the RAS GTP once formed just cannot go back to RAS GTP. So what I'm trying to say is normal cells keep a balance. When it wants RAS to be active, it produces RAS GTP. But then as soon as you don't want RAS, the cell will degrade it back to RAS GTP where the RAS is not active. In lung cancers where the RAS is mutated, RAS just cannot be degraded back to GTP, and therefore RAS is constantly active. And that is what leads to then several other proteins being constantly active, which leads to what is called as oncogenic signaling, or signaling where it leads to the cancer cells transforming into cells that divide, cells that spread. I hope I was not too technical, but I just wanted to give a brief concept as to what is the difference between EGFR and ALK. EGFR and ALK are more at the level of the cell membrane. RAS is more sort of inside the cell and is the primary point where the receptors communicate with the inside of the cell to produce an effect. And what happens in mutation is that the RAS just cannot be degraded. The cells normally want it degraded so that it doesn't function. It stops functioning. So it is always on the on position. RAS GTP is the on position, RAS GDP is the off position. It is always on the on position, and the cells just can't, in the cancer cells, you just can't get it into the off position. And this tight binding between RAS and GTP has made it very challenging to develop a drug that blocks RAS as it has been possible in EGFR and ALK. And that's the best I can explain in a sort of a simple way. Now, RAS is mutated in several cancers, not just lung cancer, and therefore there's an interest in developing drugs that block RAS mutation. So yes, it is mutated in lung, but it is also mutated in colorectal cancer, pancreatic cancer, biliary cancer, in a proportion of those cancers. I'm not saying all pancreatic cancer, all colon cancer. So like lung cancer, where it is mutated in about a quarter of the lung cancer, non-small cell lung cancers, it is also mutated in colorectal cancer, pancreatic cancer, biliary cancer. What is mentioned at the side here are the different types of mutations of KRAS. Now, in EGFR, we have started learning that we used to think of EGFR mutation as one entity. But in EGFR now, we think of exon 19 mutation and exon 21 mutation. And we have now started thinking that these two mutations have to be maybe approached a little differently, that their benefit from the EGFR drugs might be a little different whether you have exon 19 EGFR mutation or exon 21 mutation. Well, when we say KRAS mutation, it's not one type of mutation. There are multiple types of KRAS mutations. And these can be called, like we say, exon 19 and 21. It's codon 12, codon 13, and codon 61. I don't want to get into what is exon and codons. Just remember that there are different types of KRAS mutations. The most common is G12C, and the others, so G12C and G12V constitute about 60% of the KRAS mutation positive lung cancers. The rest of the mutations constitute about 40%. Why is this relevant is, as I'll mention, is that it may be relevant in terms of how you respond. So there are some data sets that show that KRAS mutation positive lung cancer is actually resistant to chemotherapy. Some data sets show that the prognosis is worse in KRAS mutation positive lung cancers. And you have data sets that show exactly opposite, where chemotherapy works extremely well in KRAS mutation positive patients. And then you have data sets showing that no, KRAS really doesn't predict for a poor prognosis. It is possible that when they did the analysis, they looked at KRAS as one group. Whereas if you divide it into these different individual KRAS mutations, it is very much possible that depending upon what type of KRAS mutation you have, your response to chemotherapy is going to be very good. Whereas if you have a different type of KRAS mutation, your response won't be as good. I mean, I have KRAS mutation positive patients who've been on Alimta for 3-4 years, and their disease is well controlled. And then I have KRAS mutations who have not had that kind of benefit with Alimta. So it would not be right. What I just wanted to communicate this is, it won't be right to just think of KRAS mutation as one single entity. We are starting to learn the different type of KRAS mutations that the patients may have.
So for the people in the audience, would that be like more than one person driving the bus?
Yes.
Yeah.
No, not more than one person by driving the bus. I would say different persons. So So one person might be driven by Dan, and another person's bus might be driven by Mike. Both might be Californians, but the way Dan drives the bus may be a little different than the way Mike drives the bus. Bus being the patient's cancer.
Right. Does that make more sense? Yeah.
Right. I don't know whether it makes sense to you guys, but I was hoping that it made sense.
So
there have been several attempts to develop drugs that target RAS, and this sort of gives you an overall summary. I'm just going to mention a couple of things about this. So this sort of gives you the way people are thinking about targeting RAS. It has been challenging, as I mentioned, to develop direct inhibitors to RAS, but I will say that there was a major paper in 2013 where a group from Berkeley did develop a drug that can inhibit, at least in cell lines, a specific type of KRAS mutation, not all, but this G12C, which is the most common mutation. So a specific drug that can, and now one expects that within a year, trials will start. So it may not be for all KRAS mutations, so there is a direct inhibitor that is in development or is about to start clinical trials. But because it has been challenging to develop drugs that directly inhibit RAS, focus has been to the downstream protein. So the way RAS produces the cancer effect is it activates certain other substances or other proteins, which then lead to cancer growth and cancer formation. And one important protein is called the MEK, M-E-K, which is downstream of RAS. There are MEK inhibitors in testing. And one such is called selumetinib. And when selumetinib was tested as single agent, it didn't produce that much of a benefit. But there was a sort of a, what we call randomized phase two, so sort of an earlier phase trial, where patients with KRAS mutation positive patients, now mind you, they included all KRAS mutation positive patients, did not sort of select based on which type of KRAS mutation they had. And they were random, and these patients had already gone through chemotherapy and their cancer had relapsed. So this is now second line treatment. And they were randomized to either chemotherapy, which would be the standard of care, or the chemotherapy plus the MEK inhibitor. And this study showed that there was a benefit with the combination. Now, by no means the benefit was something that you would see with drugs like Tarceva in EGFR mutation or crizotinib in ALK positive patients, but it was clearly better than what chemotherapy was seen, with chemotherapy was seen. But what is more important is that we are beginning to understand which particular KRAS mutation positive patients are likely to benefit and which patients may not benefit from this MEK inhibitor plus chemotherapy combination. And one is this data set where these KRAS mutation positive patients are likely to have other mutations, particularly in a gene called P53, or in a gene called LKB1. And it appears that depending upon whether the other gene that is mutated is P53 or LKB1, the benefit could be different. And so we are now going to start a SWOG trial that is going to look at a MEK inhibitor, a different MEK inhibitor called trametinib, GSK212 is also another number, with chemotherapy. But the goal is, this has already been done, it does appear to provide benefit. But what we are trying to understand is, which particular KRAS mutation positives, trying to really dig deep and try to understand which specific subsets of KRAS mutation positive patients are likely to benefit from the combination.
So this is my question. So based on what you're saying, it's not just enough to know that you're KRAS positive.
So at this point,
Even for purposes of a clinical trial?
For the purposes of clinical trial also, at the present time, the way the trials are being developed, they're still being developed in KRAS mutation positive patients. They're not going into the depth, but every trial is trying to capture the data as to what specific type of KRAS mutation you have, and trying to have at least a secondary objective in the trial that you're going to analyze which particularly KRAS mutation positive patients did derive benefit and which did not. Because I think in the future, we are not just going to say KRAS mutation positive. Like we are not going to say, I think in the future, just EGFR mutation right. positive patient, we are going to say exon 19, exon 21.
So for KRAS patients today?
Yes, they should try to figure out, as all EGFR mutation positive patients should try to figure out, okay, I have KRAS mutation, but what KRAS mutation?
And that's kind of where I was going. You a couple of slides ago, you had Dr. Yanez for MEC, right?
Dr. Yanez,
yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So for example, you don't know.
So
this
was all KRAS mutation, and what
participated in, unless you know if whether
what actually
a MEC,
the
right?
data suggested was that. It is possible that this combination uh-huh. is going to show a significant benefit in G12C patients, but not necessarily in the other KRAS mutation positive patients. That's the hypothesis of our SWOG trial. And so what it is it's further refinement, it's further precision medicine, where you are trying to identify, okay, this mutation, this specific mutation, not just KRAS mutation, but this, so think of this, we started at non-small cell lung cancer, then went down to squamous cell adenocarcinomas, then went down to EGFR mutation, KRAS mutation, but now we are delving even further in yeah. further depth. Specific KRAS mutation, and not only that, trying to find out what are the other mutations that are of relevance. So for example, we are looking in the trial to see whether the concomitant mutations on P53, LKB1 will influence therapy. So it's not just about, okay, this is the specific KRAS mutation, but what are those partner genes? I told you that even in these driver genetic alterations, EGFR, KRAS, it would be naive to think that's the only gene altered. Yes, that's the dominant gene that is making the cancer grow and spread. But there are these other genes that are also altered that are contributing to the cancer phenotype, but they may influence the patient's response to treatment.
I have a question. I'm sort of confused at what stage.
Sarat, yeah, thank you.
Sorry, at what stage this KRAS mutation will be given to patients? Does that mean that you got to go through the normal process of things like I had, like Alinta, and at that point, you decide that this particular treatment will be appropriate at that stage?
So usually, whenever drugs are developed, in the beginning, they're developed more in patients in the more advanced setting, and probably not just advanced setting, more in the second, third line setting. That's sort of the transition that we have always sort of gone into. At the present time, the study that was done was in the second line setting. That is, these patients had gone through the frontline chemotherapy like you're going through, and then they had progressed, and then at progression, they were enrolled on this study. That the study that I just showed you of Pasiani, which showed the benefit with the combination, the yellow curve is for the combination, the blue curve is for the single agent Taxotere, this was in the second line setting. This was an early phase study where it shows, this was done to see whether we even see a benefit. And now a confirmatory trial has been conducted worldwide, a phase 3 trial, and we will see whether the results of that phase 3 trial confirm the results of this randomized phase 2 trial. And only then will that become a standard of care. As of now, it is not a standard of care. It is still in clinical trial. Now, it is possible that if that trial is positive, that this may be moved into frontline setting, but it's not happened as of now. like it has with some of the other targeted agents. So yes, the frustrating aspect about this is it has to go, you know, it does take some time, and the development does follow a certain trend, because still the overall principle is first do no harm. And so we will see. The other thing you have to realize is when this study was designed, there was a belief that the MEK inhibitors with chemo will be beneficial. But not everything that looks good in the laboratory or in animal settings lands up being effective in patients. So that's why they did this study in the second line setting. If the study is positive, then they will be moved into the frontline setting.
So I have a question.
Please, go ahead.
Go ahead.
So what does it mean, life cycle, like 6 months, 8 months, a year?
That is very variable from patient to patient.
Oh,
and what I would say today to all of you with regards to that is, it is so variable that I would not go, this is where I would not go by based on what is on the internet. Because what is in the internet is, unless it's something like Bonnie Adario's forum, they give you the averages, okay? Whenever you talk about averages, the example I give is, if a player has an average shooting percentage of, like, you know, 20 points a game, right? Doesn't mean the next game the person is going to get 20 points. Person may get, or your golf, right? I don't know, whatever your score is. You know, if that's your average over like 10, but doesn't mean the next time you go on the golf course, you may do better than that, you may do worse than that. So the most of the data on the internet quotes averages, but that doesn't mean every advanced stage lung cancer patient or lung cancer patient is going to have the same outcome. The outcome can be extremely variable, okay? And the range is quite wide, and I assure you the averages are going up, okay? And so what you're reading on the internet, even though we say everything is recent, it's usually data that is at least 1 or 2 years old. And so you just have to be focused on being sure that you're getting the right treatment. So what I tell my stage four patients is that if you told me you wanted to plan a trip to the next Olympics, I would say go ahead, because I don't know if I will be able to go for the next Olympics, right? I don't know whether I'm supposed to fly tomorrow. I don't know if I'm going to land in Detroit tomorrow. So what I'm trying to say is that there are a lot of different options. I don't know whether I would have said it with the same enthusiasm 15 years ago when I started, when my only option was chemotherapy. But our options have clearly increased. And yes, I don't want to say there are patients with stage four lung cancer who do not have a good outcome. But I really believe that one shouldn't go by averages, because there's a great deal of variability.
And wasn't it, how many drugs were approved in the last
several
months of 2000?
Yeah, so in the last 2 years, there have been a total of about 12 drugs that have been approved for lung cancer.
And in the last 6 months of 2015, it was something like eight.
Yeah, I mean, in November and December alone, there were 3 drugs approved.
So I have got a curiosity question. You mentioned earlier, and then you just mentioned a couple minutes ago, that most of the therapies are used on late stage patients,
in the initial testing.
Right. So when does science or medicine determine to use some of those therapies on earlier stages as a way to increase survivability, or, you know, start to look at not a wait and see thing, but let's attack the disease earlier to see if we can cure it?
So for example, one of the things you have to realize is that the data is getting so evolved that you are finding drugs that are relevant only in the second stage. So for example, one of the recent drugs approved is osimertinib. Osimertinib is approved in EGFR mutation positive patients, but it specifically targets T790M, okay? So it was first tested in patients of T790M, and you have T790M usually after you've gone through Tarceva and progressed. Well, that's where they tested it first. Now that they've seen benefit and it works and provides wonderful benefit, now they are moving it up front. But I think from a developmental strategy, it made sense to test it in patients first T790M, and T790M occurs in the second. So it's not always the strategy that, test it in the advanced stages and then test it up front. In KRAS, there have been several attempts to look at drugs, and they have been unsuccessful. And I can tell you, in some KRAS patients, chemotherapy does provide. One thing I want to sort of say this, don't discount chemotherapy. You know, we are all into this genomic testing, and yes, that is extremely important. But even today, and even in EGFR mutation positive patients and ALK positive patients, chemotherapy has relevance. So we think of this as different tools that we have, and we use the tools at the right time for the right patient. And we have to use all the tools to get the... So there are patients who get very disappointed when they come to me, particularly if they are never smokers, and they say, oh my God, I don't have EGFR and ALK, so you're going to use chemotherapy. That means my outcome is not going to be good. By no means that means the outcome is going to be not good. And please understand that even if you're EGFR and ALK, you may need chemotherapy down the road. So what I'm trying to say is that the reason why sometimes we use some of these drugs in the second, third line setting is that you do derive benefit from standard of care treatments, and you want to have some level of evidence that there is a benefit before you start sort of changing that frontline standard of care.
And isn't it true that if you have multiple biopsies, that you can find that the cancer itself has changed,
yeah,
and that you are now eligible for something new?
So I have a question in KRAS up front, that, and then that's sort of the secondary question to it, because I want to make sure I'm understanding, and that more importantly, you know, people who watch are understanding up front molecular profiling and the importance of that, but how it goes well beyond, based on what we're talking about here, EGFR and ALK, right? When it comes to KRAS, and you talked about some of these downstream proteins like MEK, how important is it up front that those are also tested for and identified?
So
and then re-biopsied, right?
So let me sort of answer this way. First of all, about testing in general. So standard care right now is, in the, say, newly diagnosed patient, I'm going to talk first about stage four patient, because, and I'll come to the early stage patients, but in stage four patient, newly diagnosed, the standard of care is to at least test for EGFR ALK, and now, literally within the last 1 week, crizotinib got approved for ROS1. So I would also test for ROS1, because now we have an approved drug. The reason why we test for this to begin with is for twofold. One is that it may be challenging to get the next-gen sequencing done within a timely fashion. Sometimes it can take up to a month. And in some patients, it may not be possible to wait that longer period and you need to get started. So even if I'm strongly suspecting EGFR and ALK, and if a patient is really sick, I may start them on chemotherapy, because sometimes even that 5-6 day delay, which is what we need to get the results back, might be too late. So the initial testing that needs to be done is EGFR, ALK, and KRAS, EGFR, ALK, and ROS. Now, each site does it a little differently. So we have sort of these basic markers. So we do EGFR, ALK, ROS, KRAS, and BRAF. That's just a panel that our pathologists have created, but it's different with every center. But if they are negative, and again, I'm generalizing, we get started with chemotherapy, but then ensure that that patient's tumor is sent for a more comprehensive analysis. Our cancer center does not have next-gen sequencing, but we have developed an arrangement with a lab called the CARIS. So there's something called as Foundation. There are several laboratories that do these next generation sequencing. So our sort of testing pattern is newly diagnosed stage four patient, get EGFR, ALK, KRAS, ROS1, BRAF. Negative, get them started on chemo, but ensure that the tissue has been sent. And in our experience, it takes about 3 weeks or so to get the results back. Not only do we send it, but sometimes what happens is after you've done the testing, initial testing, you don't have enough tissue. And in those patients, we would even encourage the patient to undergo a second biopsy to get the next-gen sequencing done. So what you want is, by the time you need to make a change in treatment, so you start off with chemotherapy if you have not found any of the markers that you've tested for initially. You start the chemotherapy, and then you use that chemotherapy as long as the cancer is controlled. Hopefully it's 10,000 years, but you know, you just keep going. And then, and as long as the patient is doing well. And then if the patient relapses, you have that answer available. Occasionally, the biopsy is not possible. Then you biopsy at the time of progression, get that answer, and based on that profile, decide what therapy we need to do. So I hope that answers. Now, coming to the early stage patients, the current standard of care in stage 1 to 3 is still, as I mentioned before, to do surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, use a combination of those, depending upon what the individual circumstance is. And at least as of now, we are not using the EGFR, ALK, and some of these other molecular alteration information to guide therapy in the early stages, because with the standard treatments of surgery, chemotherapy, and radiation, we can cure most patients. There are trials that are being done that are evaluating the utility of these targeted agents over and above what one would see, benefit one would see with the standard of care. So yes, in select patients, we do the molecular alteration testing in the early stage patients also.
I think there's an online question.
Yeah, I have a couple of comments and questions. First comments is Tom Mundy wanted to say thank you for coming. He's online, and all the new patients that are here. And then Mara has a question. Her left lung nodule was positive for KRAS 2 years later. Her right lung nodule was negative for KRAS and other markers, both considered primary. If they come out with a drug for KRAS up the road, would I be considered KRAS positive?
It will depend upon, so hopefully these are two independent primaries. Both hopefully were stage ones and they were treated. So God forbid if the patient does have a relapse, then you would have to test and find out at that time whether that tumor is KRAS positive or not. In general, and again, there are exceptions. We discussed this before the meeting started. The KRAS, EGFR, ALK, these are considered the primary drivers. And so one expects that even during relapse, they're going to have the EGFR, ALK, or KRAS. Now, they are at relapse, they may have other mutations that have caused the relapse, and that might guide treatment. But in general, so that's what tells me that this patient had two different cancers, because one was KRAS positive and one was negative. But whether KRAS will be relevant in terms of guiding therapy will depend upon if at the time of recurrence the tumor is KRAS positive or not.
I have one more question.
Please.
What about immunotherapy for KRAS?
And that's exactly where I was coming to. So the one big change that has really influenced, I think, KRAS treatment is immune, or the one group of patients where it has produced greater benefit than some of the other groups is KRAS mutation positive, and that is immune therapy. So think of immune therapy is a very broad term, and I'm going to sort of explain what immune therapy drugs have become available for lung cancer. In general, a patient's immune system should be able to get rid of the cancer, but cancers fool the patient's immune system into thinking they are normal tissue, and that prevents the patient's immune system from attacking the cancer. One of the ways, and not the only way, one of the ways that cancers do that is cancers express a substance on its surface called PD-L1. Immune cells, so this is a cancer cell, this is an immune cell. So when an immune cell always has a substance on its surface called PD-1. When an immune cell comes close to the cancer cell, the PD-L1 on the cancer cell interacts with the PD-1 on the immune cell, and that interaction sends a signal to the immune cell, hey, I'm a good guy, don't attack me. So several companies have developed drugs that either cover up PD-L1 on the tumor cell or cover up PD-1 on the, cover up PD-L1 on the cancer cell or cover up PD-1 on the immune cell, and basically prevent the interaction between PD-L1 on the cancer cell with the PD-1 on the immune cell. When you prevent that interaction, now the cancer cannot send a signal that I'm a good guy. Now the immune cell can recognize the cancer and attack the cancer. So you are taking away the blocks that the cancer is, or the shield, sort of it's covering itself with a shield that prevents the immune system from launching an attack. And these drugs sort of unmask the cancer, and now the immune system can recognize the cancer and attack the cancer. Now, I want to make it very clear. This is the main mechanism of blocking the immune system in a proportion of patients, not all patients. And so we talk about immune therapy. That's a more broad term. What the drugs have become available are what are called these anti-PD-L1 or anti-PD-1. And so they're primarily relevant in cancers that utilize this mechanism to block the immune system. But once you, if that is the mechanism in that particular patient, then the immune system gets activated and the immune system attacks the cancer. Now, the reason it has created a lot of interest is that it actually works as second, third line. Again, this was first tested in the second, third line setting after the patients had gone through chemotherapy. As single agents, they only work in about 20% of the patients, 15 to 20% of the patients. But the reason they have generated excitement is when they work, they can control the cancer for a very long period of time. So this is a lady of mine with KRAS mutation positive lung cancer, a wonderful, wonderful 65-year-old lady whose belief, who her faith is amazing. Her sense of faith is absolutely amazing. Truly, I mean, I can't just describe it. It's truly amazing the level of faith she has. So she was diagnosed in 2013 with what initially felt to be stage 3 disease, was treated with chemotherapy and radiation, got platinum, Alimta, and radiation, and then subsequently developed metastases in the liver. And I don't know how well this shows up in the back, but there's a spot in the liver here, and there's a spot in the liver here. These scans are from April 2014. This lesion was biopsied and was proven that it was metastases of the lung cancer. So I don't know if you see this. There's a spot here, and then there's a spot here in the liver. So this lady started on one of these anti-PD-1 drugs. And this scan is from November of 2015. Actually, I didn't download the pictures from March. So she has been on this drug now for 2 years.
God.
This lady had relapsed within 3 months of finishing her chemotherapy in early 2014. So she finished her treatment in late 2013. And I can tell you that normally once they relapse this quickly, the probability, the duration of benefit with second line chemotherapy is likely to be much shorter. Usually you're talking about a few months. So not only has her disease been controlled, but actually the radiologist always calls me, are you sure this is the same patient? Because they don't see the cancer. We did a PET scan in this lady, and the PET scan doesn't light up. This lady does have KRAS mutation, has the G12C KRAS mutation. Now, I have KRAS patients who have not benefited to the same degree with immune therapy. But in general, the data suggests that KRAS mutation positive patients are more likely to benefit than, let's say, compared to EGFR mutation positive or ALK mutation positive with these immune therapy drugs. I don't want to say with, there are many other experimental immune therapy drugs, but with these immune therapy drugs. What is not clear is whether it is the KRAS mutation that is determining the benefit from these drugs or the higher probability of benefit from these drugs. Or is it the fact that many KRAS mutation positive patients, not all, many KRAS mutation positive patients are either current or former smokers? So this is data set from one of the immune therapy trials. And as you can see, the probability of benefit was somewhat higher in current or never smokers compared with this immune therapy drug compared to chemotherapy. So if the bar is to the towards this side, then this drug worked better in these patients. If the bar is towards this side, then chemotherapy worked better in these patients. If the bar is in the middle, then the probability of benefit was about the same. So as you can see, the probability of benefit was a little bit more in current or former smokers with the immune therapy drug as compared to the chemotherapy drug. So what does, yeah, go ahead.
Could that also be other carcinogens other than smoking?
It could be, definitely. Yeah. But the what appears to be the case is that, and this is a very technical figure, but I wanted to just mention this for the title of the higher mutation burden. What that means is, I told you any cancer is because of multiple genes that are altered that are making the cancer cells grow and spread. The number of mutations that are gene mutations that are present in any cancer is higher in smokers or former smokers as compared to lung cancer patients that are never smokers. So genetically, if I can say, the cancer in a smoker or a former smoker is a lot more dirty. There's a lot more genetic mutations. Whereas in a never smoker, the genetic difference between a normal cell gene and a cancer cell gene is far less. What does that have to do with response to immune therapy? When you have a lot more mutations, the cell is going to have a lot of antigens on it than a cancer on a never smoker. So whenever you have a higher number of mutations, the cell is going to express many proteins, substances on its surface that are different than what is expressed in a normal cell with a normal set of genes. I hope I'm sort of getting that across. So in cancer cells which have a higher number of mutations, those mutations lead to abnormal proteins, different from the normal proteins. And therefore, the immune system has a better ability to recognize. Immune system is developed in our body not to recognize normal tissue, or at least not to attack normal tissue. So when the distinction between cancer and normal tissue is much more, immune system is able to recognize that more easily. So the distinction between a higher mutation cancer as compared to a lower mutation cancer, the distinction between normal tissue and cancer is a lot more in the higher mutation cancer as compared to a lower mutation cancer. This is not to say that the currently available immune therapy drugs won't work in never smokers or light smokers, but the probability of benefit is likely to be somewhat less than it is in a former smoker or a current smoker, just because these patients are likely to have a higher mutation burden. I hope I was able to convey that.
And isn't it also true that immune therapy is so new, we really don't know all
Absolutely.
Of the people
and,
that
and
it's
please understand
for.
That this data set now has spurred interest in developing other immune therapy drugs. And this is relevant for the currently available immune therapy drugs. Doesn't mean that the other immune therapy drugs that are coming along, that this difference would be relevant. And this is, at the present time, a hypothesis, a sort of a suggestion that this may be the reason for this observation, that the currently available immune therapy drugs are a little more likely to work better in the current and former smokers as compared to never smokers. And again, I want to be very, very careful when I say this. This does not mean that the drugs don't work in never smokers. The
Right.
only reason I wanted to bring this up is that in KRAS mutation positive patients are generally more likely to be current or former smokers. And whether that is the reason why these drugs work better in KRAS mutation positive patients as compared to EGFR mutation positive and ALK mutation, ALK altered lung cancer patients, or it is something intrinsic to the KRAS mutation positive lung cancers
yeah.
that determines greater efficacy, we still don't know.
Right.
Do you see also the higher mutational burdens in patients who have been exposed to some of the other things we talked about earlier, whether it be radon or
So the two cancers where these immune therapy drugs have shown the initial benefits, and it is possible other cancers will see benefits, but the two cancers where the drugs have been approved already, these immune therapy drugs, and again, I want to emphasize, it's these immune therapy drugs, there are other immune therapy drugs coming along which may have, is melanoma and lung cancer. And if you plot all cancers, and the average number of mutations that one sees in these cancers. So if you created a chart of average number of tumors in, let's say, prostate cancer, average number of mutations in breast cancer. And so whenever you have an average, there's a range, but if you average it out, the tumors among solid tumors among adults with the highest number of mutations are melanoma and lung cancer.
Sun exposure, I'm guessing, is...
So chronic sun exposure leads to these multiple mutations that lead to melanoma. And it's that, you know, chronic smoking or some other exposure. But in never smokers, in general, the number of mutations... Yes, there are mutations that have caused the cancer. Of course, that's why the cancer occurred.
Sure.
But the number of mutations are lower. And so the cancer doesn't look different from normal tissue to the same degree that the cancer with a higher mutation burden looks to the immune system. So the immune system can recognize that this is not this is a foreign person.
So,
then,
so that would include...
So I would be easily recognized. I'm not from California, right? I can remember. But if I was a little more fancy, then
as
I would
soon
be
as
recognized
you start
California.
Talking.
Yeah.
No, but my question is, so the mutational burden wouldn't necessarily be higher for a, for example, never smoker who grew up on some horrible radon field.
Right, it is possible, but in general, in never smokers, the mutation burden is lower.
Gotcha.
Compared to a smoker.
Regardless of, gotcha.
Yes. So the inciting carcinogen may be different in never smokers, of course, environmental pollution, radon.
Sure, sure, sure.
But in general, the mutation burden is not the same in a never smoker.
Gotcha.
I'm sorry, Stephen.
Can I ask a question? Mostly a question for the audience, for the group for you to answer. So if we use the analogy of the immunotherapies, the checkpoint inhibitors, uncloaking or revealing the cells to the immune system, we know that there are efforts going on to also train the immune system to recognize those cells. So could you make a comment on those?
So there are several attempts being made to basically train the immune system to recognize the cancer and kill the cancer. This is a very, very simple representation, but at the end of the day, what you're trying to do is get these active T cells or active immune cells that can recognize the cancer and attack it. So I'll give you an example of what we are hoping to do. We've just got a grant funding for, is that we have a person who actually does stem cell transplants for blood cancers, and he has developed a technology where he takes the T cells of patients and he sort of modifies them in the lab, wherein he adds on to these T cells molecules that can help recognize the T cells recognize lung cancer. And so we start the patient on chemo. That's the plan. We have not yet done this, but that's the plan. They start on chemotherapy. While they're getting chemotherapy, we collect their T cells. They continue their chemotherapy. We process the T cells, wherein the T cells can recognize the, sort of add molecules onto the T cells in the lab, the patient's T cells, where they can recognize the patient's lung cancer. Then after they've completed chemotherapy, instead of continuing the Alimta, which is the standard of care, sort of maintenance Alimta, we give them the T cells. Now, the T cells can be blocked by this PD-1, PD-L1, so we are going to give them the currently available immune. So we're going to give them the patient's T cells back, which hopefully will reach the cancer, will recognize the cancer, and if any sort of blockage is put up by the cancer, that will be removed by the PD-1 drug that we'll be giving, anti-PD-1 drug we'll be giving, and the combination together hopefully will produce. This is one very, very simple way. There are multiple different ways that people are looking at to train the immune system. Why this is exciting, if I may, I just want to finish this thought. Why this is exciting for somebody like me who's focused on lung cancer is, there have been multiple attempts made over the last 25 years to develop immune therapy treatments for lung cancer. And all these attempts failed, and failed miserably. There was absolutely no benefit. There were vaccines tried, variety of steps were tried. It was only after these immune checkpoint inhibitors or anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 drugs that were introduced that we started seeing benefit. Yes, in a minority of patients, but phenomenal benefit. And that changed the concept that before it was felt, this is an immune therapy tolerant cancer. And now we have a cancer that does respond to immune therapy. It's just that you have to identify what is going to trigger the patient's immune system in that particular patient's cancer. So there are a variety of ways of trying to do that. And the only reason I wanted to mention the KRAS, in KRAS patients is that there is definitely data to suggest that KRAS patients have a greater probability of benefit from the currently available immune therapy drugs than compared to some of the other patients. So I wanted to sort of conclude, and we can go into the question answer session, that KRAS mutation patients are more commonly seen in smokers, though it can occur in never smokers. Variety of KRAS mutations, so when we think of KRAS mutations like EGFR, we can't think of it as one entity. There are different KRAS mutations, and they may have relevance in terms of which drugs we will be using in the future. There are something called as concomitant mutations. So these KRAS mutations, some patients' cancer may have P53 mutation. Other patients' cancer, along with the KRAS, may have LKB1 mutation. And that may influence the therapy that we give to these patients. That's what we think in the future, though we are not there yet. The chemotherapy plus MEK inhibitor trial has shown benefit, but a phase 3 trial has been completed, and we are awaiting the results to see that the initial results observed with this combination, do they hold up? And if they do hold up, then it will become a standard of care. And the anti-PD-1 and anti-PD-L1 drugs have shown a greater benefit in KRAS mutation positive patients. So this was sort of a summary of KRAS. I thought something that would be interesting, but I would love to answer any questions you have.
I would love to see you talk just for a little bit, because we're slowly, the clock is ticking, and there's so much information. I think everyone, especially our KRAS patient, would like to hear a little bit about how close we are to beginning to chronically manage lung cancer.
So one thing I want to say, even today, KRAS mutation positive patients, so KRAS mutation was viewed as this tumor type that doesn't have a good outcome. I can tell you that there are patients, there is data sets to show that certain KRAS mutation positive patients do extremely well on pemetrexed or Alimta chemotherapy. As I've mentioned, I have a KRAS mutation positive patient who actually did not do so well on the anti-PD-1. We had an anti-PD-1 trial in the beginning, like as first line treatment, and did not do well on the anti-PD-1 drug, but now is almost 2.5 years out on Alimta, and comes once a month for Alimta chemotherapy and is doing well. So I don't think KRAS has the same negative connotation to it that it had a few years ago. I think we have options, and I think it is definitely going to improve. Are we there like we are with, say, you know, do we have the same options or the different options we have, let's say, for EGFR or ALK? No, we are not there yet, but there are definitely options coming along. And I think that in some ways, certain drugs like these anti-PD-1s might work better in KRAS mutation positive patients than some of the other groups of patients.
Linda, did you have a question? I see you holding the mic.
I have a question. It's just technical more than anything. Some of these trials, et cetera, say that you have to be PD-1 positive or et cetera to go in the trial. But how do you even test for that? I don't understand. Is it blood or tissue or what?
So the frontline trials, there are, like I mentioned, these immune therapy trials were done primarily in the second line and third line setting. Some data sets show that if the patients, when you do the biopsy, you can test for whether the cancer, patient's cancer, has the PD-L1 on its surface. And if they have PD-L1, the probability of benefit with these drugs is greater. But it doesn't mean that if you don't detect it, that the drug is not going to work. Yes, the probability is lower, but the drug can still work. And if it works, the duration of benefit is the same. It is sustained even if your tumor was PD-L1 negative. So in general, in the second, third line setting, we are not routinely testing for PD-L1. Having said that, in the frontline setting, they are doing trials where they're testing for PD-L1, and if the patient's tumor is PD-L1 positive, there are certain trials that are randomizing patients to either chemotherapy, which is the current standard of care, or to an anti-PD-1, PD-L1 drug alone to see whether you would derive not only the same benefit as you would with chemotherapy, but maybe even better benefit. Whereas we are doing trials where we are taking everybody, all stage 4 lung cancer patients, and we are randomizing them to chemotherapy or chemotherapy plus an anti-PD-1 drug to see whether the addition of PD-1 drug to chemotherapy provides greater benefit than what you would see with chemotherapy.
So for example, for nivolumab or Opdivo, for those of you who have seen the commercials all over TV.
It's the same drug.
Yeah, it's the same drug. But it's true that it doesn't require testing to be prescribed.
Right, so the way the studies were conducted, you didn't have to have PD-L1 testing to go on the study, and so the approval is irrespective of the PD-L1 testing. Keytruda, which is the other drug, and I call them Coke and Pepsi. I mean, they're about the same. Of course, once I've said that and the patient said, no, I hate Pepsi, I only like Coke. So don't you say Coke and Pepsi. But what I'm just saying is that Keytruda, the way it was developed, you had to have the PD-L1 testing. And so it was approved only if your tumor is PD-L1 positive. Though I think the probability of benefit is the same.
Yeah.
So we've got 2 minutes. So I wanted to give a chance for Katie to give a quick update on some of our upcoming events for those who might be interested in participating, who might be signed in or watching a little bit later. So Katie, I'm going to turn it to you for a second.
So we have a few exciting events coming up. The next city that we'll be in is going to be Dallas. We're going to be in Dallas on April 16th. And then after that, we're starting a brand new event. It's the first one for us. April 30th will be in Sacramento. So we have those two coming up for the 5K series. So if any of you guys want to come, take part, fly to Dallas, be a part of that, we'd love to see you there. On the endurance side, we have bibs left for the Chicago Marathon, the New York Marathon, the Disney Marathon. I hope I'm getting these all right. But if you're interested, and by endurance, what I mean is it's a half marathon or a full marathon. So we have the 5K series, and then we also have the half and full. If you're interested in any of these, feel free to shoot me an email at katie@lungcancerfoundation.org, or you can go online to our foundation website at lungcancerfoundation.org, go to the events tab, kind of click through which location you're looking for, and then find the specific event page.
And for endurance,
yes.
We're not necessarily expecting our patients to run
half and full
marathons, but if you know people
who are
into that, I wouldn't be one of those people, but who are into the marathon running, these are typically hard marathons to get into, and we do have the bibs available. Yeah.
And then we do ask that participants do some fundraising for it, but we'd love for you guys to pass along the information and spread the word for us. And then also, the events team has a newsletter, so keep your eye out for that. And that's probably it from the event side of things.
Did you have something really quick to add?
Yeah, really quick. We just went zero. Online? Or at zero?
Yeah, we're at zero.
Everyone just want to say what a great speaker you are, and thank you. They are very impressed by you, and it's been very informative. You know what?
So, and with that, I was going to do our thank yous. Actually, before I go to thank yous, next month, April 19th is our next living room. Dr. Bonomi from Rush in Chicago is going to be out talking about supportive care and managing side effects and what role that plays in treating your cancer and the benefits to really looking at this type of supported care at diagnosis. So we're really excited.
He is amazing. And I'm not just saying that. Dr. Bonomi is
side effects.
We're excited that he's coming out.
He's amazing.
Out. Side effects are greatly, under.
You couldn't have a better speaker.
Yeah, that's great.
Great. So we're excited about that. A huge thank you, obviously, to our sponsors: Genentech, Lilly, Celgene, Merck, Novartis, and Astellas. Without whom, we wouldn't have the funding to be able to put this on for all of you. So we're really appreciative to them.